This buffet that we have this morning is on 3D echo. And let me start out by asking from the audience, how many of you have a 3D capable machine at your institution now? How many of you have that? Typically, it's about 20%. I think in this audience, it's actually higher. It's about 30 to 40%, it looks like. And what I'm happy to see is that we go through conference after conference, the number of physicians who have embraced 3D technology is growing. But there's another part that I also see is that many people will buy a 3D capable machine and then never use it, or perhaps never use it to its full potential. At our institution in Whitefield, we use 3D echo every day. And I'll show you some examples of how we can make 3D practical. And it all starts with understanding the principles so that we can get great images every time. So I don't have any disclosures to declare, but I do want to start with an old story. If you remember about 15, 20 years ago, the first cell phones came out, and we all thought it was an amazing thing. They were quite big, bulky instruments, and when the next generation came out, these analog phones, it was thought to be a huge technological advance. Then we had these candy bar-sized phones, which brought the technology to a really, truly miniature state. But then things advanced, and you had these flip-type phones, and then the first BlackBerry by Research in Motion came around, and that was the very first smartphone, as you can see here, and it was a huge technological breakthrough. And then the phones came out, iPhone, the very first iPhone 1 was a tremendous advance because this concept had never been thought of before. And then you got iPhone 2, 3, 4, and so forth. And pretty soon, none of us would ever leave home without our cell phone. I know that when I go out of the house, I check for my wallet, my keys, and my cell phone. And if I somehow leave home without my cell phone, I feel like I've left my leg or my arm at home. So we don't go anywhere without this. And of course, nowadays you have iPhone 5, and then iPhone 6 and S5 have come out. And the technology continues to advance. And 3D echo is really the same way. This is one of the first 3D echoes that I did back in 2006 at the Cleveland Clinic. This is from a TAVI case. This is the aortic valve shown here, and you can see the catheter has been advanced from the retroaortic route, and the balloon is being inflated with the device, and you can see the device being deployed across this calcified aortic valve. Now, if I had to show such an image today, I'd be pretty embarrassed. I mean, these images are really terrible, and at that time, what we were doing, we just gave up on 3DT because it was so cumbersome, and so we were doing things like CT scan, high, you know, 128 slice CT. We were able to look at the coronary artery ostium and the relationship of the prosthesis to the ostia height and so forth, and that gave us very useful information. But we still needed advances, and so technology continued to grow until we can do things like this. Here's a guy who's saying it's the hottest new diet. You attach this special modem to your stomach, you attach this special modem to your stomach and upload your fat to a skinny person on the internet. And so 3D technology has become like this. The technology has advanced so much that you can get beautiful images like this. This is a patient with a mitral valve prolapse, although you don't really see it so well on this mid-esophageal 0 degree and 90 degree view. But from the left atrial view, that is a surgeon's perspective, you can see the anterior and the posterior leaflets shown here. This is the left atrial appendage and the aortic valve, the aortomitral curtain, and the intervalvar fibrosis partially seen here. And you can see this P3 prolapse shown here, which is the cause of this patient's mitral regurgitation. So we're able to get beautiful images like this, and we have a number of modalities that we use 3D for, just like we have, say, pulse wave Doppler, and we use pulse wave Doppler for looking at the flow across the mitral valve, across the LVOT and so forth. We have different techniques or different ways that we can use 3D. And 3D is a modality. Those of you who've been to echo conferences over the past, you'll recall all these speakers get up and they talk about 3D and they say, if you're not using 3D, then poo-poo on you. I mean, literally, this is what would happen. But it's a modality, and it's a very useful modality, just like pulse wave, just like continuous wave Doppler, just like color Doppler. None of us would do an echo study purely using pulse wave Doppler and said, I've done an echo study, right? We would combine everything together to give us the best possible clinical information. And the same thing is true with 3D. We don't use just a 3D exam, but we use 3D to complement or supplement the information we're getting from 2D. So there's different ways to use 3D, and one is this multiplanar mode, which you've seen here. This is a transthoracic echo showing a four-chamber, two-chamber, and three-chamber view. And we might use this for interventions or for dobutamine stress echoes. We can combine combine this multiplanar mode with the classic volume rendered mode that you're used to seeing. And so then you get, in this patient who has LV non-compaction cardiomyopathy, you can see this dilated, actually the ventricle is not so dilated, it's the atria which is dilated. And the arrow gives you the perspective that you're seeing across the mitral valve. And when you look into the left ventricle, you can see the classic channels that this patient has because of the hypertrabeculated left ventricle. When we do a multi-slice tomographic stack, as if we're cutting the heart like a cucumber slices, just like this, then you can see from the apex here all the way down to the base of the heart by the mitral valve, and you can very nicely see the classic channels and lakes that are so common in this particular disorder. 3D has really grown to be the reference standard for non-invasive assessment of LV volumes and function. MRI is a current gold standard, but current technology has shown that with the latest generation 3D, the end-diastolic, end-systolic volumes, ejection fraction, cardiac output, all the data that you get is actually quite accurate. In this case, this is a transesophageal echo example, but it's very useful in critically important situations such as in the ICU, in the operating theater, or just in routine evaluation of patients in the OPD where you're looking at what is their actual ejection fraction. Suppose you have a patient with asymptomatic mitral regurgitation or aortic regurgitation. You want to know what are the volumes, are they changing over time, what is the ejection fraction, is it decreasing over time, and so forth. And you might add this with strain to get a comprehensive evaluation of the patients. Sometimes at our institution, we do use dobutamine stress echo daily, and we use 3D for this. So we'll start with an acquisition from, in this case, the rest acquisition from the apical windows and from the parasternal windows here, giving us a long axis and short axis at the same time. And in this DSC, you can see that during stress, this patient has hypokinesia in the mid-anterior septal wall and in the mid-to-distal anterolateral apical walls, as shown here. We also use for quantification of regional wall motion, and we've seen that over the last few days with strain and strain rate, including radial, longitudinal, circumferential strain, as well as area strain, which is basically just your length times your circumferential, longitudinal times your circumferential strain. And these types of measurements nowadays are quite easy to use, and we can actually quantify this when we're using stress echo to look at areas of ischemia during DSC. Now, all that sounds good, but it's very important that you use this technology properly. I think what we saw yesterday was very interesting. We had a patient who had coronary artery disease. Actually, we didn't know the history when we were doing the hands-on evaluation in the back room. We had a patient, and we were doing strain analysis, and one person did not get very good image quality, and he got a global longitudinal strain of minus 12, which is reduced. Another person got medium quality, and he got a global longitudinal strain of minus 14, and then one person got very good image quality, and we got a global longitudinal strain of minus 15, all of which was reduced. It turned out we didn't know the history at the time, but the patient had a history of coronary artery disease and had just undergone stenting, angioplasty and stent to the proximal LAD, which explained his reduced global longitudinal strain, even though his ejection fraction was reduced. 3D is the same way. We saw in this strain example, we saw three different people get three different results, but the quality or the results hinged on image quality. And when your image quality is good, your diagnostic confidence and your accuracy of your diagnosis goes up tremendously. In non-invasive imaging, see, if you're a surgeon and we have surgeons in the audience, we know what can happen if we have a mishap or some untoward event, adverse event in the operating theater. For non-invasive physicians or for physicians who are doing non-invasive imaging as part of their work, the mishaps or the adverse events happen when we make mistakes in diagnosis. And that starts a whole downstream series of events that can lead to many, many adverse events for the patient. So having very good diagnostic quality, making sure you're measuring the right thing is very important for getting the right diagnosis. In the ICU, 3D is very useful because if you take the 3D volumes and ejection fraction that we just now showed you, you can actually get very good and accurate assessments of ejection fraction, volumes. You can look at what happens when you give a fluid challenge, for example, or using inotropes. You can measure your stroke volume. And these are all very useful in these critically ill patients. And even in things such as this, which is a post-infarct ventricular septal rupture, you can actually see the shape of the VSR in this case, in this patient who had an anterior myocardial infarction by 3D. So that's all good, but again, it goes back to image quality. 3D is fantastic, but you have to have very good image quality to get this. And so in the next 10-15 minutes, I'm going to talk about how we get good image quality, and then we're actually going to change gears, and I'm going to do a live demonstration with Ashwin, our senior sonographer, and show you a case of how we would use 3D and how we use these same principles. So There are five steps for 3D, and I tried to simplify this. I wanted to make it something like the three most awesome steps to get great 3D images, but it just wasn't working out. It's going to be five steps for 3D, and this is what you need to do. First, you have to optimize your 2D images, and because that's probably the most important thing. Second is you have to select your 3D mode, and I'll go through each of these step by step. Third is you're going to select your volume size. Fourth, you're going to acquire your image from the right window. And then you're going to crop, threshold, and display. But basically, I think we need to step back even before then. Swami would say something which I wish I had heard like years ago because it would have saved me a lot of headache. He said, first be clear, then everything will follow automatically. Many of the times we run into problems in our lives because we're not really clear about what we want or how we want to go about it. When we have this clarity, whether it's in our studies, whether it's how we run our departments, whether it's how we move forward professionally or academically, when we have that clarity, then things do happen automatically. The same thing is true for imaging. And when we're clear about what we want to image and how we want to image, then our diagnostic confidence and accuracy goes up. So first, we're going to optimize our 2D images because suboptimal or lousy 2D images will create lousy 3D images. So here, you need to pay attention. Use your ECG leads. Pay attention to your frequency, your depth, your sector width, your focus, your TGC. We'll have a separate live demo of this a little bit later today. But with 3D, you have to do a few things a little bit differently. You're going to keep your TGC slightly higher than normal, and you're going to keep your gain around 50 to 60. So you're going to just slightly overgain, which is what is seen in this image here. If I had shown this as a live image, I would probably reduce the gain a bit. But when we're doing 3D, we just slightly overgain, just not a lot, but just a little bit. And I'll show you some examples of this. But make sure your 2D images are perfect before you do anything related to 3D. Next is you're going to select your mode, because there's different types of 3Ds that you 3D modes that you can do. So we're going to look at these, and first is the live 3D format, and the second is this multi-beat format shown here. Live 3D is good. This is basically what we do for 2D, right? 2D is what we do routinely. It's just live 3D, or live 2D rather. So this is the same thing. This is an example of a patient who had an intraatrial septal defect, and we did live 3D to help guide the procedure. But when we put in the TE probe, we found that what we thought was a single defect by transthoracic echo on the multiplane image actually ended up being two different defects with a rim separating the two ASDs of just 3 millimeters or so. So we managed this patient surgically instead of device. In this case, this is another example of a live 3D. This is a patient who had, this is a 12-year-old patient. This is given me by Dr. Shivakumar from Madras Medical Mission. This is a patient who had a single disc, a St. Jude's mitral valve replacement put in at the age of 12, and then 9 months later, he presented with severe paravalvular regurgitation. And so this is the 2D images shown here. You can see your Nyquist velocity is quite high, and in this image, variance has been turned on, which explain in the color scale is a bit different. But that's you can see that this is the prosthesis here, which is partly shown with the typical reverberation artifact here, and this is the mitral regurgitation. So they decided to close this defect percutaneously. You can see the two discs of the mitral valve leaflet, or the mitral valve prosthesis are moving normally. The two poppets are moving normally. And there is this, obviously, this defect shown here. But when you do the 3D, this is from the left atrial side shown here. This is the arrow, and this is your particular imaging plane above the valve. So here are the disc of this St. Jude's valve, and here is very clearly seen the paravalvular leak. It's basically a hole. And what 3D allows us to do is to actually see the shape very clearly, because sometimes these can be circular, they can be elliptical, they can be crescentic, and so with 3D you can actually see this and plan your intervention much more carefully. So here's the actual live TE being done. You can see here the catheter has been advanced across the defect, as shown here. Actually, you can't see it on the 2D images. I mean, if I were to guess here, I'd say, yeah, there's a catheter there, probably. But where exactly it is, I don't know. So, but on the 3D images, you can see the tip of the catheter quite clearly. And then agitated saline is ejected across the defect to make sure that the catheter is truly across the defect and not across the valve disc, for example. And then we go ahead and advance the catheter further, we create our usual loop, and then we deploy the device. And you can see the device is seen very well from this side, but by the 2D images, you can kind of make out where the device is, but not really. but it's really the 3D that gives us that information. This is another view of the same thing. And then when we place color, we can see that there's no flow across this defect. It's been closed completely. And then we can see that the, as usual, when we do these types of structural heart disease interventions, you want to make sure that whatever you've just deployed, whatever device you've just deployed, is not impinging on adjacent structures. In this case, we want to make sure that the disc of the prosthetic mitral valve are still opening normally without any impingement on disc motion. We make sure there's no associated MR, and so on and so forth. So this is an example of how live 3D can be used. The next mode is the multi-beat mode, and this is slightly different. Here what we're doing, and I'm sorry that this doesn't play, is basically we're taking the heart, and instead of just imaging one slice, we're imaging multiple volumes across the heart. So we get one volume here, another volume here, and another volume here. When we do 2D, we get sectors. When we do 3D, we get volumes, and we can adjust the size of the volume based on whatever object we're interested in. So when we do multi-beat, we're imaging the heart in several heartbeats, unlike routine 2D imaging where we're just capturing one beat or one particular few seconds of the heart. The advantage of multi-beat mode is that it gives us very good temporal resolution, but to do this, you have to have normal sinus rhythm. The patient has to be able to hold their breath if you're doing a transthoracic, or if the patient is under TE, then you have to have the anesthesiologist, if the patient is ventilated, then do a breath hold for you, and you have to hold still. So the patient has to hold still, and you have to hold still. And you can get anywhere from 2 to 7 beats per acquisition, depending on what you want to see. So this is an example of by TE of multi-beat mode. If it looks pretty good here, but you see there's a little bit of jumping, and you see these things down here, this is called stitch artifact. This is where, even though we have a pretty good frame rate of 20 frames per second, that's our temporal resolution, what's happened is there's been a breath somehow during this time, and so we're getting the stitch artifact. So then we ask the anesthesiologist to hold the breath, and we get a slightly better image, although we still have to optimize. You have to have normal sinus rhythm, and you have to hold still. The patient has to hold still. So that's a multi-beat imaging. The next step is to select your volume size. And volume, like I said, is how big is your image in 3D plane. So you can adjust your volume thickness. And on this machine, we have a small, medium, or large. If you use larger volumes, you're going to get lower temporal resolution. This is true in any imaging modality. The bigger your imaging space, the lower your resolution, whether temporal or spatial resolution goes. So when you use a larger volume, you're going to get a lower temporal resolution. But what I like to do when I select my volume is I want to find not only the object of interest, but I want to look at adjacent landmarks, because that makes it very easy to adjust the plane so I know exactly where I'm looking at. Nothing is more confusing than doing a 3D imaging and then not knowing what you're looking at. But when you have adjacent landmarks, let's say you're doing the mitral valve in this patient with mitral stenosis, if you see the aortic valve, you can very easily make out which is going to be the anterior leaflet, because the aortic valve will be right next to it, for example. So the other thing to do is adjust your volume so that you completely capture the image of interest. So here's an example of a TE that was done, and this is a patient with mitral valve prolapse, and you can see on the 2D image, we are not capturing the entire mitral valve annulus. Probably the annulus has become a bit dilated over time. You know, mitral regurgitation begets more regurgitation, MR begets MR. So what you can see here is on the 3D, we've actually lost a part of the mitral valve. So you have to adjust your volume size so that you're truly capturing the entire object of interest. And this is why when you're in the learning stages of using 3D, it's very helpful if you have a fellow or resident along with you, because if anything goes wrong, like in this case, you always have somebody to blame. So that's what happened here. Okay, next step is to acquire the image from the appropriate window, because different windows will give you different types of views, and some views are better. This is for transesophageal echo, but what I'll do today is show you by transthoracic echo some of the different views that we use. And then finally, the last step is to crop, threshold, and display. This is where you take the raw data and you turn it into something beautiful, something that you or the surgeon or the anesthesiologist can look at and say, ah, I get it right away. So here's an example, and I'll end with this example. This is a raw image of a patient by TE of the aortic valve. And we've just acquired from the mid-esophageal 120-degree view. This is the complementary short axis view. This line here shows a particular plane at which the 3D slice is taken, and the arrow shows a particular perspective. Now, usually for the aortic valve, we would like to view the aortic valve from the aortic side. This is the surgical perspective that the surgeon uses when they're doing an AVR or surgical myectomy, for example. And so we're going to start from here, but although there are other uses from the ventricular side. And you can see this is a normal aortic valve, but there's really not much you can do with this. So we have to do a couple of things. I've just zoomed in so I can focus on the aortic valve and see this more clearly. This is my intraatrial septum. Remember how I said we should always try to capture a little bit of the adjacent structures, not too much, because if your volume is too wide, you're going to sacrifice temporal resolution, but just a little bit. Why? Because now I know this is my intraatrial septum, so I know this is my non-coronary cusp, and I can see a little bit of the RVOT, so I know that this is going to be my my right coronary cusp shown here. So these adjacent structures make it easy. Now, if I undergain on my machine, and then I get an image like this, which is no good. This is basically, I get dropout, it looks like there's holes in the cusp, and so this is no use at all. On the other hand, if I overgain, you can see what happens here and the corresponding changes in the 3D image. Again, this is also not so useful. So I need to optimize my gain just right so that I'm not getting holes like this. I just need to optimize it. And then finally, I'm gonna turn this around because I want this is my right coronary cusp, and this is the correct image. I want my right coronary cusp to be at 6 o'clock. This is the standard display for the aortic valve is at 6 o'clock. When Dr. Allegation talks about 3D in the mitral valve, he'll show you the standard display for the mitral valve as well. And then finally, I might twist it around and show the image from the LV view. I would probably use the LV view if I had something like a subaortic membrane, for example, and I wanted to see where the fibrotic membrane was or the ridge of tissue was in relationship to the valve structure. There's nothing in this case, but this would be is if I were looking up from the LVOT up through the aortic valve, and then the aorta is on the other side. So there's different uses for the different views depending on what you're going to do. But whenever you're getting 3D, you always need to start with good images. This is an example of a tricuspid valve. This is a tricuspid valve stenosis, and here you can see the raw image. Now, what I showed you before in these previous images is when you have the autocropping feature that comes on the modern machines, it really makes it very easy because you don't have to do any work. You just acquire the image, you make sure that your volume or your object of interest is in the center of your volume, have a little bit of your adjacent structures, optimize your 2D, 3D gain, etc., and then just turn it so that it's in the standard view. In the aortic valve, for example, the right coronary cusp at 6 o'clock. That's fine. Now, for other images, like the tricuspid valve, the autocropping is not yet developed because there's so much variability. So typically, we do what's called a two-click crop, which is where we start from here, and we drag a line across this, and that allows us to see the tricuspid valve. I'm not going to do the processing here for you because we actually have the same image on the workstation reviews when we meet after this session, so you can actually crop this for yourself and get the nice, pretty images that we all like to see. This is what happens when we do a two-clip crop. We're not yet done because this image by itself is still not useful, but then when we're finished, we get an image that looks like this. This is looking from the RA side, and you can see this patient with tricuspid stenosis. The cine doesn't look like it's playing, but this is a septal leaflet shown here. This is a posterior leaflet, and this is the anterior leaflet. And what we've done is because with the tricuspid valve, you place the septal leaflet at 6 o'clock, we've captured a little bit of the interventricular septum here, so we know exactly where the septal leaflet is. That's, again, the importance of capturing those adjacent landmarks. So cropping, threshold, and displaying are your last steps. So I think let's just review this. We're going to optimize 2D images. We're going to select our 3D mode. We're going to select volume size, and then we're going to acquire from the appropriate window. Let's go ahead and switch though, because it's not enough for me to talk about it, but we need to show you. And then after we go into the hands-on session, we're going to actually make you acquire these same images. So we're going to switch over and give the display from the Vivid E9 machine.